I'm sorry. Show business isn't for me. I'm going back to Allentown.
What was that word you just said? Allentown? I'm offering you a chance to star in the biggest musical Broadway scene in 20 years, and you say Allentown?
Springhouse Middle School Theater Experience from The Mouse of Babes. The performance you'll be viewing is a culmination of a six-week virtual workshop during which students from all grade levels at SMS learned songs, skits, and monologues from famous Broadway shows featuring teen and tween roles. Students were introduced to seven Broadway shows spanning over 70 years of musical theater history. From Neverland to New York, from the past to the present, into the garden and through the woods, our students glimpsed what it means to be a young adult in a variety of times and places, both real and imagined. In each story, the characters are like so many of the students in our workshop, in the process of discovering who they are and who they want to be. For the last 2 weeks of the workshop, we have been working in teams to prepare a glimpse into each of the seven shows. We rehearsed, wrote, and narrated the background information you'll hear at the beginning of each show segment. We also rehearsed and recorded our monologues, scenes, and songs. And of course, we enjoyed each other's company and collaborative energy during the production process. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the show.
Broadway musical Annie is based on the Harold Gray comic strip Little Orphan Annie, which premiered in the 1920s. The music for the musical was directed by Charles Strauss, the lyricistic director for the musical was Martin Charnin, and the book was written by Thomas Meehan. The musical opened in 1977 and ran for almost 6 years. It set a record for many theaters and had many productions in different countries. It also had many national tours and won 7 Tony Awards, including the Tony Award for Best Musical. The show was only written in 14 months, but took 4 years to get onto Broadway from lack of interest in the producers. The original actress for Annie was Kristen Bygaard, but after a week of performing, she was replaced by Andrea McArdle because they needed someone who was tougher. The story is about a little redhead orphan named Annie. She was very different from the other orphans in that she was always very positive and full of optimism. One day, she gets invited to a millionaire named Daddy Warbucks' mansion. She was happy at first, but soon she just wanted to have a normal family and she was unhappy. Later, she gets adopted by Daddy Warbucks and is happy. In the performances you will see, Annie is singing about how she wishes she could have a normal life, but most of all, her parents back. In the monologue, Annie is at the millionaire's house for Christmas, and they want to take her locket off. but Annie does not want them to because her birth parents left it with her when they dropped her off at the orphanage.
No, please don't take my locket off. I don't want a new one. This locket, my mom and dad left it with me when they left me at the orphanage. And there was a note, too. They're coming back for me. I know, being here with you for Christmas, I'm real lucky. But I don't know how to say it. The one thing I want in all the world more than anything else is to find my mother and father. Be like other kids, with folks of my own.
Maybe far away, or maybe real nearby. He may be pouring her coffee, she may be straining his tie. Maybe in a house, all hidden by a hill. She's sitting playing piano, he's sitting playing a bell. So maybe now this prayer's the last one of its kind. Won't you please come get your baby, maybe.
Is a musical based on J.M. Barrie's 1904 play Peter Pan and his 1911 novelization of it, Peter and Wendy. It features a score by Morris Moosejaw and Joel Stein, with lyrics written by Carolyn Light, Betty Comden, and Adolph Green. The iconic songs, along with the story, take both the children and adults on a trip they will never forget, transporting them to the magical world of Neverland. When the classic fairy tale Every Family Loves finally made it on stage at the Winter Garden Theater on Broadway on October 20th, 1954, it sparked a revolution, traveling the world and enchanting audiences for around 60 years. After winning a Tony Award in 1955 and receiving other Tony nominations, it has also become the most frequently performed family favorite. One of the main characters is a young boy named Peter Pan who does not like adults at all. However, Peter knows that he too will eventually become an adult one day, so he goes to a magical place called Neverland, where time passes slower, meaning it takes much longer to grow up. In Neverland, there are mermaids and there are fairies, whose pixie dust can make anyone and anything fly. And, well, Peter has a never-ending supply of pixie dust because he has a vain fairy sidekick named Tinkerbell, or Tink as Peter calls her, and when she talks, she sounds like a bell. So that's Peter Pan, the boy who never grows up, and his fairy sidekick, Tinkerbell. The story tells of Peter Pan and Tinkerbell. Together, they visit the nursery of the Darling Children one night in search of his shadow, and, with a little bit of pixie dust, they embark on an unforgettable magical journey. In this once-in-a-lifetime adventure, the travelers encounter a crocodile, an Indian tribe, a group of pirates, and the infamous villain, Captain Hook. So let's go and see what Peter is up to. Join me and take a trip to the fantastical world of Neverland, where no one ever grows up.
Whoa! No wonder they made this into a play. This book is heavy and ripping apart. It's way too old. Alright, let's see. Where are we now? Oh my! It seems Peter has lost his shadow once again.
Come now and join us in this magnificent hunt with Tinker, Mirabelle, and Peter for In Search of a Shadow. You know, if I've read this book enough, and I have, it occurs to me that Peter might actually sing a song. Imagine that. It could be called I've Got a Crow.
Tink! You see my shadow? No. It's gotta be here somewhere. You know, you used to be a lot better at finding stuff like this. Yeah. You used to be able to find Lost Boy in no time. Tink! Why are you chattering so much? I knew I'd find it quicker than you. Look how amazing my shadow is. Now, just need to find a way to attach it back. Give me some soup.
I've got a crow. I'm just the cleverest fellow 'twas ever my fortune to know. I taught a trick to my shadow to stick to the tip of my toe. I've got a crow, but naturally, when I discovered the cleverness of a remarkable me, how can I hide it when deep down inside it just tickles me so that I've gotta let go and grow?
By James Lapin with music by Stephen Sondheim, debuted on Broadway in 1987. Into the Woods is a product of a workshop at Playwrights Horizon in New York City. Into the Woods has remained popular for over 30 years, and in 2014, Disney made a movie version of Into the Woods. Into the Woods is a dark, whimsical musical intertwined with magic that pulls you into a world of classic fairy tales, but with an unexpected twist. Some of the characters include Cinderella, Little Red Riding Hood, or Little Red, Jack from Jack and the Beanstalk, the baker and his wife, and the witch. As the result of a curse of the once beautiful witch, a baker and his wife are childless. Seeking to break the curse, the baker and his wife venture into the woods under the witch's instructions to find the ingredients that will reverse the spell and restore the witch's beauty. A cow as white as milk, hair as yellow as corn, a cape as red as blood, and a slipper as pure as gold. During their journey, they meet Cinderella, Little Red, Rapunzel, and Jack, each one on a quest to fulfill a wish of their own. However, is what they wish for what they truly want? Will the show end with a happily ever after? We will now get to hear a song and scene from this show. In the song, Little Red sings about her encounter with the wolf, and the lessons she learned from the animal. After the song, as a token of her thanks, she gives her beloved blood red cape away to the baker. The scene is between Little Red and Jack. After Jack stole the golden egg, he stumbles upon Little Red and stops to admire her new cape. Little Red fiercely protects her cape and threatens Jack, which leads to the two boasting about what they have. Following that, an argument is sparked between Little Red and Jack over whether Jack is telling the truth or not about his adventure with the giant and the treasures he stole and saw.
What a beautiful cape! stayed away from my people, sliced me into a thousand bits.
I don't want it. I was just admiring it.
My granny made it rain from a wolf that attacked us, and I got to skin the animal. And best of all, she gave me this beautiful knife for protection.
Well, look what I have. A hen that lays golden eggs.
I don't believe that egg came from that hen. Where did you get that egg?
I stole this from the kingdom of the giant up there. And if you think this is something, you should see the golden harp the giant has. It plays the most beautiful tunes without you even having to touch it.
Of course it does. Why don't you go up to the kingdom right now and bring it back and show me?
I could.
You could not.
I could.
You could not, Mr. Liar.
I'm not a liar. I'll get the harp. You'll see.
And he showed me things, many beautiful things that I hadn't thought to explore. They were off my path, so I never had dared. I had been so careful, I never had cared. And he made me feel excited, well, excited and scared. And I know things now, many valuable things that I hadn't known before. Do not put your faith in a cape and a hood. They will not protect you the way that they should. And take extra care of strangers, even flowers have their dangers. And though scary is exciting, nice is different than good.
Is a musical set in the 20th century and was first debuted on Broadway on April 5, 1991. It was based on a novel written by Frances Hodgson Burnett. The music is composed by Lucy Simon and the playwright is by Marcia Norman. The novel was published in 1911, becoming one of his greatest novels ever written and seen as a classic in English children's literature. This musical is about a girl named Mary Lennox who is a neglected and unloved 10-year-old girl. Born in British India to wealthy British parents who never wanted her and made an effort to ignore her. After a cholera epidemic killed Mary's parents, she is sent away to India to live in the manor of a brooding uncle she has never met in Yorkshire, England, where her personality blossoms among the other residents and the manor as they bring new life to a long-neglected garden. The song you are about to hear is called The Girl I Mean to Be, and it's about Mary who is longing for a place where she can be alone with her thoughts. After that, you will see a scene portraying Mary Lennox and Dickon discussing miscellaneous items in the garden.
I need a place where I can go, where I can whisper what I know, where I can whisper who I like and where I go to see. I need a place where I can hide, where no one sees my life inside, where I can make my plans and write them down so I can read them. A place where I can bid my heart be still and it will mind me. A place where I can go. I mean to be.
please show me. Puppies come up pretty hard. They bloom if thou listens to them. What is the Romanesque calling us?
Is he really calling us?
He's saying, see here, come up with the chat. Robin's to come with. He'll tell you all about it. I'm in a minute.
Is he actually like me?
Aye, he's big enough to marry me, Mr. Barry.
You will understand everything he would say.
Kiss him the more so long. Something breaks down, stop legend out. Kiss him one of them.
Perhaps you are.
Sometimes, but they have a bird or a bee when they don't even have it. He's lost or come up with another dog. Ask them. See here, I've landed the dog.
Well,
I... Mother says, that time we give Miss Mary a leaf for the ground, where have you started?
I don't know
really. Father, Mrs. Farman, then excuse me, Anne.
Can I keep a secret? I don't know what I should do, so I think I might die.
Stop making secrets, they'd be not safe on the wall.
I've stolen the garden. Nobody walks there, nobody points to it.
How about a garden?
The garden's mine now. Robin has a right to live here. I'm the only one who cares, the only one.
How can you not see your garden?
Come, I'll show you. The wind swept aside the prison eye for a long way. Suddenly, I looked up and said, the door.
Picture this, a big 1800s house looming before you, surrounded by a field of green grass. What else do you see? I know what I see. I see four young girls, each in different areas of the home. Amy, the youngest of the four, is dreaming of a future with ball gowns, riches beyond her wildest dreams, and a wealthy husband who can supply those riches. Beth, the second youngest, is in her own thoughts while playing piano in the living room. Joe, second oldest, is most likely in the attic, watching her wildest fantasies float off the pages of her writing. Lastly, there's Meg. She's in the living room as well, knitting while she thinks of what life would be like if they were rich. This is Little Women, a story of four sisters who go through the twists and turns of life together, all while living their own separate fantasies at the same time. We get to watch the girls grow up, get married, make friends, like Lori, their next door neighbor, become independent, and experience their finest dreams. While the story unfolds, we find out that Jo has been writing the story of her unique family for the world to share and love. 16 years ago, on January 23rd, 2005, the first crowd of people got to experience Sutton Foster as Jo and Jenny Powers as Meg. These two women, plus the eight other people in the cast, performed Jason Howland's music, Mindy Dickstein's lyrics, plus Alan Lee's script, and took the classic story to the stage. Today, two Springhouse students are going to show you their versions of the classic characters. In our first monologue, the character of Meg March is going to talk to her mother about romance and a certain next-door neighbor. Next, Jo is going to show you her complaining side as she whines about men and dances. Now introducing Little Women.
I hate going to a dance. People ask to dance. Unless you happen to be a boy, which solves the whole thing, because then you can stand with your back to the wall and frown down on everything. I mean, when a girl goes to a dance, any minute, some person can step up and ask to dance with you. And you're hurt if they don't, and disgusted if they do. And then you're out there on the floor, and they're trembling all over your hem of your dress. And then, next thing you know, people start thinking things and saying things, and bad goes to worse, and some young man comes calling. And then you get married. The very worst thing.
But then, standing at the punch ball in my borrowed gown, I started to feel peculiar. I couldn't quite remember who I was. And when the gossip began, I wished with all my heart I was home. I'm sorry for the gossip, Mother, but I didn't invent it. I think I'd best tell what they said and get it off my mind. They all think that you have what they call plans for us and Lori, because he has money. that you want us to know lore, so he'll marry us. I mean one of us.
First produced on Broadway in 2007, 13 is a musical by Jason Robert Brown. The musical is known for having no adult roles and only having a cast of teenage actors. It is also known for being the professional debuts of Ariana Grande and Elizabeth Gillies, who will later go on to star in Nickelodeon's hit show Victorious. In this story, 12-year-old New Yorker Evan Goldman is planning a bar mitzvah. Evan is under pressure to have the best bar mitzvah imaginable, and on top of that, his parents are having a divorce. But just as Evan thinks that maybe things will be just peachy, his mother calls to inform him that they are moving to Appleton, Indiana. However, fear not, for this is where the story really begins. When Evan moves to Indiana, he befriends a new neighbor of his, Patrice. Patrice is quirky and offbeat, and is more than ready to begin her life away from Appleton, Indiana, which in her eyes is the lamest place in the world. Later on in the show, when she feels that Evan is becoming less and less of a true friend, she sings a song, What It Means to Be a Friend. The show focuses on typical characters and events in the life of a middle school student. Evan meets Brett, the most popular kid in school, Kendra, the prettiest girl in school, and Lucy, the head cheerleader and Kendra's best friend. When school starts, Brett summons up the courage to ask Kendra to a scary movie and tells Evan to get his mother to buy them all tickets to the Bloodmaster. Lucy and Kendra both like Brett, but Brett is only interested in Kendra. Because of this, Lucy is massively jealous and will do anything to split them up. She ends up intervening during the movie date between Brett and Kendra, and this results in Lucy and Brett getting together instead. However, this doesn't last long before Lucy and Kendra get into a friendship-severing fight. Like I said, typical middle school drama. We are now going to present two monologues and a song from 13. The first monologue features Patrice showing Evan around his new and seemingly bland town. The second monologue will feature Lucy, jealous over Brett asking Kendra to the movies and not her. And the song that will be performed, What It Means to Be a Friend, is sung when Patrice is starting to doubt the genuinity of the friendship between her and Evan. Now sit back and enjoy the show.
Let me get this straight. Your mom decided to move to Appleton, Indiana because your cousin Pam lives here? Wow. Sounds like the divorce got ugly. So you're gonna have your bar mitzvah here? The one day of your life, everything's supposed to be happy and perfect. See, Catholics don't have that day. It'll go against everything we believe in. You say you're looking for the best DJ in the best ballroom of the best hotel? That would be the Best Western. Sorry, but your choices are like my life here. Limited. Come on, I'll show you the hillside where everyone waits for the resurrection.
Brett, wow, lucky us running into you when I'm looking so hot. You did not just brush me aside and ask Kendra to go to the movies on Friday night. No. You can't go to the movies on Friday night, Kendra. I said she can't go. You can't go because you're already committed to that thing. You know, that thing. That thing you said you would do on Friday night? What do you mean there's no thing? Yes, there is, Kendra. Don't contradict me in public. We'll talk about this later.
Friend's not a cheap little phony creep or a jerk trying to make a deal. A friend is a person who most of all cares about what you feel. And nothing is harder than learning your friend isn't real. A friend sends notes back and forth all day and doesn't care that you can't spell. A friend know you got a crush on your teacher, but a friend would never tell. A friend's outside waiting the minute you both hear the bell. And if your heart is always breaking, Cause the world is just not fair. When you're at your worst, your friend's the first one there. Giving you something to lean on, and that's what it means to be a friend.
Family was a comedic television show created by Charles Addams that premiered in 1964, which tells the story of the unusual Addams family. 45 years later, it was brought to stage with new characters, astounding sets, and music by Andrew Lincoln. This show has included famous faces such as Kevin Chamberlain and Nathan Lane. The musical has won a Drama Desk Award, an Outer Critics Circle Award, and numerous others for its ability to capture the setting of the production. The main character in the show is Wednesday Addams. Wednesday is a monotone, apathetic girl that lacks emotion. She's commonly known for being very pale, black hair in noose braids, and black dress with white collar. She is very attached to her family and becomes unsociable to the outside world. Throughout the show, Wednesday goes through a journey as she changes from apathetic to full of emotion. She falls in love for the first time and realizes how much of the world she has been missing. These new feelings awaken something in her to change, which she sings about in the song you'll be hearing later. The creepy tale of the Addams Family centers around the character of Wednesday Addams falling in love for the first time with a boy named Lucas Fink. She struggles to find a space between their two worlds and tries to get her families to get along or at least tolerate each other. It's a phenomenal story about dealing with change, falling in love, and one family of all. As the family attempts to have a normal dinner family party with the Dunique family, they learn what being normal is like. Some members of the family, such as Patricia and Gomez, find it harder than others, such as Wednesday. As the dinner is beginning to crumble, Wednesday announces that she and Lucas plan to get married. This turns things from awful to worse. This musical excursion uses song to convey the roller coaster of emotions that not only Wednesday but every character goes through. The song you will be hearing is Cold, which is Wednesday's realization that there is a whole world out there, and she feels as though she needs to change in order to experience it. She speaks figuratively about being pulled in a new direction and liking things that she never did before she met Lucas. The monologue Family Meeting shows Wednesday playing the drill sergeant role in her family as she commands them to prepare for the dinner party with the Beniques. It shows how hard she is trying to become a new person and how hard she tries to get her family to have one normal night. Now enjoy a look into the creepy yet fantastic world of Addams Family.
I don't have a sunny disposition. I'm not known for being too amused. My demeanor's locked in one position. See my face, I'm enthused. Suddenly, however, I've been puzzled. Funny rabbits make me wanna cry. All my inhibitions have been muzzled, and I think I know why. I'm being bold in a new direction, but I think I like it. I think I like it. I'm being bold in a new direction. Through my painful pursuit, somehow birdies took root. All the things I detested, impossibly cute. What do I do? As I'm pulled in a new direction.
Okay. Family meeting. About tonight. Now, here's the schedule. First, we'll have drinks, like, hi, nice to meet you. And then we'll have dinner at 8, and they can be back at their hotel by 9:30. Daddy, please, it's just a dinner, and they're dying to meet you. And I promise Lucas. And you know how I hate to break a promise. Daddy, I'm your only daughter and your eldest child. And if you can't do this one thing for me, then I just don't know what.
Yeah.